Hello, welcome to the Will to DIY. This podcast is a place for me to sandbox ideas, play with them, tinker with them, build on them, or perhaps just throw them away and get back to work.
Today, we're going to talk a little bit. I've got some notes, and this might be a little bit of a mess, but it was some stuff by Benjamin Bratton that I stumbled across a while back. And of course, I'm always thinking about the DIY individual as this person who's always rejecting parts of society at one point to do it themselves. And they're actively participating in society, right? They're fixing up their house to increase the value of it, or they're going to Home Depot to buy something. So as a consumer, they're participating. But perhaps these people are rejecting certain political views or participating in other political views, because they're definitely participating in communities to learn a lot of these things. So one thing about them, though, is I would assume they have a goal, they manifest their goal, they find a way to make it happen. They take action to alter the world around them. DIYer isn't looking to others to solve the situation for them. They're taking it on themselves. They're not looking at the government or whoever else to solve these things. So these aren't typically your people are sitting on their butt. They are doers. These aren't the whiny, mouthy person. These are the kick-ass bootstrappers. They're not the people who rent a furbished apartment, right? They're probably not renters at all. They're not given to complaining about the decor. They fix the decor. They are active. One of the things that I think about with some of this, where we get starts getting into this idea of the double, is there's this image of wanting to be an active doer. And then there's the form of perhaps maybe you are a whiny bitch. And sometimes those two can overlap, where even the whiny bitch can find an acorn, and all of a sudden you're perpetuating this image, this myth of yourself, where you have for a long time worn a disguise, but then this disguise becomes real. So these images and forms can be also influenced by social pressures on you, right? It's not just these interior actions, but it's how the world reacts to you. And there's this kind of choice in which you can find a spot in which society wants you to be there, and you can groove in that area, right? This is an area you're comfortable grinding in. So they say you're a carpenter or a social activist, and you get more traction in that groove. Thus, your image in that groove becomes stronger and eventually maybe becomes the form that you take. Because what ends up happening is the more we perform repetitions, that's how we create a persona. And we cease to sort of be an actor at some point, and we're acting as in we're playing in society, but we actually become the thing, and we embody these roles to perform these social roles. When we start looking at this another way, the governance of a state is highly dictated by the intended form society wants to see. So if society wants to see you behave a certain way, then the forms become reality. And these forms are all started through this image. So the image comes first. One way to think about this is that the vestments of an archetype in society that the society wants already exist. So you can think of the uniform, the corrupt politician. You can think of the kindly teacher, the narrow-minded military leader. These kind of uniforms already exist, and we need bodies in those uniforms. So the image exists, we perpetuate it. And thus, whenever we're working on ourselves, there is a doubling action that takes effect. There is the creation of the self that is desired socially, and then there's the self that is always dissembling and disassembling that current self so that we can maintain a state of autonomy or individuality within ourselves. So in a digital realm, for instance, the double or the duplicates, it's always out of date. It's in need of a sync, but its existence, its backup self, allows for an experimental practice of disassociation. So this thing isn't just this clone, this double isn't just a doppelganger or a mimicry, but it allows for these multiple camouflaged provisional beta tests. In this way, every interaction we have is sort of expanding the self and negating the self, allowing us to move forward and backwards simultaneously within this kind of idea of change. It's a creates sort of a looping effect where there's the potential for forward momentum. But more generally speaking, maybe doubling the self, it tends towards this idea of becoming schizophrenic and a limited self, where it's sort of just like multiple self-awarenesses. And honestly, I would think that one self is not enough. I think that this doubling provides a capacity for us to sandbox and hold on to multiple ideologies, maybe pursue the idea of a beneficial corruption or potential redemption in some area. It can sort of house this epic mythological pantheon in yourself that is completely flawed and ungrounded and defective, and all of the finality for that is deferred. So you don't have to collapse anything into this conclusiveness. It's always deferred in favor of growth and alteration. This would be the image of the form and the form of the image so intertwined that they become adaptive and highly complex. This doubling once again allows for a kind of sandbox where you can both accept and reject the image, and you can participate in the form without becoming the form. This for me is this kind of life form state that the DIY individual exists in, where you're manifesting reality through actions. You're not shifting so far into the archetype of ideas or the archetype of the simple machine that you end up losing perspective on how to negotiate multiple ways of being.